Mode.
Good afternoon, everybody. My name is Jose Perez, president and founder of PCMS Consulting. Very quickly, before I introduce the session, for those of you who have not been on a GoToWebinar before, you are all muted. We have a lot of people on the call, so we're going to keep the noise down. So if you have a question, you can go to the little tab, ask a question, and we will see it and get back to you with the answer, either during the presentation or at the end. So again, my name is Jose Perez. I'm the president and founder of PCMS Consulting. And today's session is, what does the brokerage of the future look like? Welcome to Camp Reinvent. We founded the company in 2007 with the idea of helping brokerages reinvent themselves. And we spend all of our time learning about what's happening in our industry and helping brokers to make the changes necessary to survive. So as you all know, there's been a lot of changes that have occurred over the past few years that have really had a dramatic impact on the profitability of our industry. Some of them have been market-driven, that foreclosures, depressed prices, low sales volume, discount brokerages, etc., have really put a downward pressure on our profitability. And then the consumer has continued to increase their expectations of what they want online. 87% start their searches online, 75% choose the first agent to respond. Just all kinds of facts that you need to be aware of, because the consumer is really driving a lot of the changes that are occurring. So in the past, when there have been previous real estate recessions, you know, the market would bounce back and everything would be okay again in a couple of years. Well, it's not going to happen that way this time. The market is going to be flat for at least another 3 to 5 years. And so if we don't change, it's going to be very difficult for us to make any money. In addition, those expectations of the consumers continue to increase. Consumers control the information. Therefore, if we don't bridge that gap between those expectations and the innovation that we deliver as an industry, it will be very, very difficult for us to expect those consumers and those agents that serve those consumers to come to us. So where does that leave us? Well, it leaves us broke. You know, I can't think of a lot of people that are making tons of money in real estate these days, and they're chasing less volume. A lot of brokerages are out of sync with the consumer, out of sync with the age of the future, and in need of a serious reinvention of their company. So tomorrow, we need more revenue streams. We need to focus on driving, engaging, and responding to web traffic, and we need to create a more positive consumer and agent experience. Once again, we have to keep in mind, in today's environment, people do not want to be sold. They get really turned off when we try to sell them something. They want help, and if you're a real estate agent, manager, or owner, you have to be the person that they look to for help. They don't want to just buy a house. They want to figure out where they want to live next. And that's really something that I think you need to take away from here today as you look at your reinvention and look at that and think, okay, how can I become indispensable to these consumers? So this time, as I said earlier, there is no choice. The old paradigm, we networked at the chamber, board, or country club. That's where people got to know us. That's where they got to feel comfortable with us. And eventually, that's where they would want to do business with us. Well, today, you have to also network online. You have to establish relationships online with social media, blogging, where people get to understand who you are online before they ever pick up the phone and call you. Next, because of mobility, you know, everybody's got a PDA. People are just as comfortable going to Starbucks for a meeting. You know, it's eliminated the need for a lot of the bricks and mortar that we grew up with over the years. I travel all over the country and go to 10,000 square foot offices and there's 3 or 4 people in there. It just doesn't make any sense anymore. Next, we have to engage consumers online through our website and other online activities so, again, they feel comfortable when they're ready to do business with us. Next, as you all know, newspapers and real estate magazines are out the window, effectively, because everything that happens in real estate in terms of a marketing perspective is happening online through internet marketing, search engine optimization, listing syndication, et cetera. And then finally, if someone walked into your office today, would you let them sit there for 30 minutes? No, of course you wouldn't. Getting right back to people is really, really important, especially online. Consumers expect a response within 15 to 30 minutes. And unfortunately, as an industry, we're just not cutting the mustard in that area. So the emerging brokerage paradigm starts with you, and I applaud everyone who's on the phone participating in this call because you know you have to reinvent yourself and your management team. So you have to start with the broker and his management or her management team reinventing themselves, because you're not going to have any credibility whatsoever with your agents and with your consumers if you yourself aren't going through the process of reinventing yourself. Next, you must have an engaging web platform because, again, 87% of consumers are starting there. So when they get to your site, they've got to feel like, hey, I'm getting the information that I want in an entertaining fashion, and so they feel comfortable and they do business with you. The next part of the pyramid is you have to understand internet marketing. So social media, search engine optimization, lead management are all critical to drive that traffic to your website. So those are the three most important foundations of the emerging brokerage paradigm, because without those three things covered pretty effectively, the agent of the future, whether that person is 30, 40, 50, or 60 years old, is someone who understands the importance of all these things in order to get buyers, sellers, listings, and closings. So it's really critical that you start with yourself, and again, today is the beginning of that journey. I was just driving by a billboard this afternoon on the way to start this call, and I saw a quote on a billboard that said, every journey, no matter how long, begins with one step. And the journey that you're beginning today is reinventing your brokerage. So there's different parts of your brokerage. There's the owner, there's the manager or managers, there's the agent, the staff, what your online strategy is, and what you're doing with your physical plan. Unfortunately, before we can start, we have to really take a look at this statement right here. And it's a somewhat of an exaggeration, but I tell you, these comments came from a top-level real estate executive that I know and told me this 2 or 3 years ago. The agents are afraid of the consumer, so when the consumer says, I don't want to pay 6 or 7%, they say, okay, I'll do it for 5 or 5.5. The managers are afraid of the agents, so when the agents come and say, hey, I want a 90% split, okay, they figure out a way to do it at the detriment of their company, because that's why a lot of us are not that profitable. And finally, the owners are afraid of the managers, who might walk out the door with a bunch of agents, so they don't hold them as accountable as they should. So whatever level of truth this statement means to you, it's something that you have to start today to get rid of, because the market is looking for leadership and innovation. He or she who leads will win. And I can tell you stories from all over the country of companies that have come to this realization and are doing the things necessary to reinvent themselves, and they are making progress. So how do you reinvent yourself? Well, it's difficult. Real estate folks over the years have been very, very resistant to change. So what you have to do is you have to start by creating urgency, forming a powerful coalition within your organization with a vision that you communicate that unfreezes all those old paradigms, throw out all those old thoughts, and think outside the box. You as a leader have to then remove the obstacles that are keeping people from reinventing themselves. Create short-term wins, because remember, it's not going to happen overnight. It may take some people 6, 12, 24 months before they achieve what they need to achieve to be successful in the future. And then finally, once you get there, anchor that. Make that part of the corporate culture. Change should be part of everybody's culture. PCMS Consulting, I can tell you right this second, we started our company right at the beginning of this recession, which obviously wasn't really great timing, but you know what? It's forced us to be better, because we constantly are not only helping our clients reinvent themselves, but we are reinventing ourselves. If you go to our website after this call, PCMSconsulting.com, you're going to see a brand new website that we just launched yesterday, because we saw that our old website just wasn't cutting it anymore. It was good a year ago, a year and a half ago, but it wasn't going to work anymore, so we changed it. And so there are little things like that that become anchored in your culture that allow you to be the leader and the innovator in your market. Another thing that we see people doing that I wish they wouldn't is be confident in who you are. If you're a traditional broker, understand what it takes to be successful as a traditional broker. You have to deliver leads. You have to provide a lot of service. Okay? And if you do all those things, you can't pay out a 90% split. If you are a discount broker or a virtual broker, you're collecting a monthly fee with a transaction fee when a sale happens, and everybody keeps their commission. So as a result of that, unless you have hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of agents, it's going to be very difficult for you to provide some of the services that you need to do. So I throw up these models of companies outside of the real estate industry. Nordstrom sells clothes. Walmart sells clothes. Well, at Nordstrom, the clothes are a lot more expensive. You know why? Because they have a very nice location. They have a guy playing the piano in the lobby. They have a lot of high-end salespeople. They have to pay all those things. And there's certain people that have no interest in those things, so they shop at Walmart. But there's certain other people that don't want to shop at Walmart. They want that other experience, so they shop at Nordstrom. Both these companies are very successful, yet they have completely different models. So what I'm saying is, if you're a traditional broker, you don't have to become a discount broker or a virtual broker. And if you're a virtual broker, you don't have to become a traditional broker. You just need to know who you are, what your audience is, and just be true to that model. So let's talk about the owner in the brokerage of the future. The owner has to be open to change, expect change, and embrace change. The owner has to demand accountability of his or her team, the managers, the agents, the staff. Because unfortunately, one of the things that I see across the industry, and I think we have to be big boys and girls and admit it, is that we don't really hold ourselves as accountable as we should. We don't measure enough things, and that's one of the things that has hurt us as the real estate market has gone down. The owner needs to be focused on the brand, his or her brand, online and offline, and how that brand is generating business for the company. We can't just leave it to the agents to generate business. We have to generate business, you know, on their behalf and for our company. The owner also has to figure out how to create multiple revenue streams. The only people that I know that are making any amount of money in real estate today are the people that own mortgage, title, and other companies within their business. The brokerage model is not very profitable anymore. So as a result of that, you need to figure out how to make money in other ways. And finally, the owner is a visionary who leads by example. But there's one other thing the owner needs to be. The owner needs to be an equity builder. What I mean by that is a lot of real estate companies don't have a lot of value today because they don't have a lot of equity because they're not making a lot of money. So the owner has to figure out how to create equity in his or her company because otherwise they won't be able to sell for any kind of money. And so imagine, and I know a lot of people like this that have been working for 20 or 30 years, have no value in their business and just shut the doors or walk over for a split to work for somebody else. That's a sad state of affairs. And our job at PCMS Consulting is to help people build equity within those within their business. The first part of that is reinventing themselves so they know how to deal with today's consumer, today's agent. And the next part of that is figuring out how to build revenue streams and make a profitable business so that in the next 3, 4, or 5 years, they can have a business that is worth selling. Next is the manager. Should we even call them managers anymore? We started a group, if you are on LinkedIn, we started a group in LinkedIn called RE Leader Search. Really, and the purpose of this group is to discuss what the role of the manager is, what the manager of the future should look like, and apparently we've hit a nerve because we started this group about 2 weeks ago. We've already got 260 members, so if anybody's interested in joining our group and joining the discussion, please go online to LinkedIn or send us an email and we'll send you an invitation. But the manager of the future, again, has to be open to change. What good is the owner being open to change, expecting and embracing it, if his or her management team is not willing to do so? Some people are, some people aren't. The managers also need to be willing to be held accountable. Because once again, if the manager is going to hold the agents accountable, then of course the manager needs to be held accountable him or herself. Very, very important. The manager needs to be tech savvy. Part of the research that we did for RE Leader Search is we did a poll asking the group, I think we put up 5 questions. What's the most important role of a manager today? Overwhelmingly, I think like 90% of the people said the manager today should be a motivator / coach. In fact, I will tell you companies like Intero calls their managers leaders. At Properties in Chicago calls their managers performance coaches. So, you know, we may want to look at what that role is. And in some cases, the manager's role maybe doesn't even exist anymore. Maybe the person we think of as a manager should be the motivator coach, and maybe we have a separate person who's recruiting, and maybe we have a separate person that's dealing with technology. We don't, you know, again, every market's going to be a little bit different, but you have to look at what the role of your manager is if you're going to reinvent yourself. Next, we have the agent of the future. Well, what does this person look like? Well, do you see a common theme here? This person's also open to change, also expecting it, and also embracing it, also willing to be held accountable. Today's agent is tech savvy. The one that is successful and making money is tech savvy, is very coachable, in fact, wants to be coached, wants somebody pushing them, wants somebody to help them figure out how to be better. That person is also mobile. That person is just as comfortable with their BlackBerry or their iPhone sitting down at Starbucks and doing their business there as they are having to sit down in an office. They still need to have an office to go to close and interact with people, but they don't necessarily need to have the big fancy private office. They are also professional, and last but not least, and also very, very important, they need to be indispensable to the consumer. What I mean by that is what I hope our team is to our clients. When there's a big decision to be made, I want our clients to feel like they've got to pick up the phone and call us because, you know, we've got the information they need to make a decision. This should be no different with your agent. If someone has a decision to make about where they want to live, not the house they want to buy, they want to learn about the neighborhood, the city, whatever it is, they need to feel comfortable that agent is looking out for their best interest and not just interested in making a commission off the sale of that home. Remember, in today's environment, people do not want to be sold. They don't want to be sold online, and they don't want to be sold offline. You've got to be providing value and become indispensable to that consumer. So your staff, I believe that your staff should basically be a concierge to your agents and your consumers. Again, people that understand that the industry is changing, people that are willing to be held accountable, but people that should be able to take those non-sales tasks out of the hands of the agents so that the agents can become more productive. Should an agent be sitting there worrying about flyers? Should an agent be sitting there worrying about SEO and other lead generation tasks? Again, based on who you have and who your market is, you need to take a look at that staff and say, okay, for every dollar I'm paying this person, I'm making $3 because my agents are more productive. Okay? So take a look at it. Maybe you call them the concierge. Again, today's environment is all about creating an experience. And if you can create a good experience, people are going to be tied to your brand. So now, online strategy. This is probably the area that I think most brokerages fall down on. And the reason they fall down on this is because they look at everything in silos. They look, okay, I've got to have a website. I don't really understand how to drive traffic. Okay, people are telling me about SEO, and I'm starting to do stuff on Facebook, and then I give the lead to the agents, and there's really no real online strategy. And there's four pieces to online strategy. First is driving traffic. How do you drive traffic? Well, you do search engine optimization, you do social media, you blog, you do listing syndication. All those things drive traffic to your site. Okay, and by driving traffic to your site, you now have the opportunity to engage that consumer. Well, here's the problem. If you don't have a good website, it's going to be difficult to engage that consumer because if you don't have an easy-to-use website that's got engaging and relevant information, then they may leave. And so if they leave, that's not good for you, and it's not good for your agent. So you need to make sure there's no reason for that consumer to leave your site. You may do a great job driving traffic to that site, but if they leave, you've wasted the money. And here's where a lot of people waste money. They waste money because they do all this effort to drive traffic and engage the consumer, but then they leave it solely to the agents, and unfortunately, 48% of agents don't call that internet lead back. The other 52% call back within a day or two. Well, guess what, folks? Today's internet consumer expects a response pretty much right away, certainly within the hour. And we have Secret Shop customers for the last year and a half, and I can count on one hand how many folks I thought were doing a pretty good job. And if you don't have a system in place to make sure that that consumer is getting a call within at least an hour, or no less than an hour, I should say, then you probably are losing business. And so it's important to have a system in place to do that because that is the expectation. Problem is that most agents don't want to work with those internet leads because a lot of them aren't ready to buy today. But they might be ready to buy in 6 months, so why throw them out? Finally, post-close marketing, in a lot of cases, consists of sending somebody a newsletter for 6 months, or sending somebody a refrigerator magnet, or sending somebody some recipes at Christmas time. Well, guys, in today's environment, the consumer, even after they buy the house from you, they are still online. And so if you can continue sending them relevant information that they care about in a professional and consistent manner, for as long as they own their home, then you're going to have a much better chance of determining when they might be in the market again than somebody who's sending cookies and stuff like that. 90% of consumers say they would use the same agent, only 11% actually do. So as you can see here, it's all one big strategy. Okay? All these sites that you have here, all the syndication sites, all the blogging sites, and all the social media sites, that's all designed to drive traffic to your site. Okay? So that's the one piece of it, okay? You got to engage the traffic, as I said earlier. This is a website that we worked on a couple of years ago. Look at it compared to the new website, okay? Do you like the eye doctor? Do you like this one? Or do you like this one? Okay, today's call is not about this. We have a whole call about how to engage traffic, but you get an idea of the difference between a good website and a not-so-good website. I talked about the stats about responding to traffic, and your ROI on your web investment is probably not as high as it should be if you don't have a system in place to do so. And then finally, the post-close marketing is another important part that nobody is really paying that much attention to. Finally, the physical plant, the office. Again, I talked about earlier, smaller, an experience, a touchdown location for someone. Mobility has changed everything. So offices can and should be smaller. This is a sample of a cafe office in California where, you know, this company is basically, you know, recruiting a whole new type of agent that is much more comfortable working in this kind of environment than the typical old school, you know, busted private offices kind of situation. You know, it's a different environment. People should be outside. In fact, I will tell you this. Real estate is an outside sales business, not an inside sales business. So how do you become the brokers of the future? I've covered a lot of ground here and hopefully generated a few ideas, but it's not going to happen overnight. You have to have short-term and long-term goals. Short-term, okay, how much do you have right now to invest in reinventing your company? Some of you may be struggling to pay the bills. I can tell you right now, a social media effort, signing up and understanding how to use LinkedIn, signing up and understanding how to use Facebook and Twitter is hardly any money at all. And so you can start developing a presence there. So based on what your situation is financially, you can be more or less aggressive. But even if you're not making a lot of money, that doesn't mean you can't reinvent yourself. Reinventing yourself is a mindset. So start up slow and understand who you want to be. The longer term goals are, you know, take those small victories that you have at the beginning, and a few months it'll lead to larger ones. Understand what you want to look like this year and next year, and determine what you have to do starting today. So Camp Reinvent was designed to help start getting people thinking about doing these things because, you know, in our experience, a lot of people just, you know they need to do something, they're just not quite sure what it is they need to do. So we designed Camp Reinvent as a way to get people thinking about it, and hopefully we got a lot of people thinking about things today. On January 20th, we're going to talk about how today's online consumer looks like. What are they looking like? What are they looking for? So that you can start thinking about what maybe needs to be on your site. On February 3rd, we are going to have someone come in and talk about how to drive traffic to your site. How does SEO work? How does social media really drive traffic to my site? I don't know a whole lot of people that have really figured that out. They're doing it because everybody else is doing it, but they don't really know why they're doing it. And that's one thing that you need to understand so that you know how to effectively drive traffic. Then on the 17th, we are going to look at a lot of websites and show you how you engage the consumer on your website. What is, again, on the 20th, we're going to talk about what people are looking for. And then on the 17th, we'll talk about, okay, well, now that you know what you're looking for, right, how do you engage them on your site? So we're going to do a lot of before and afters of different sites and, you know, get you to understand what's important and what people are looking for. On March 3rd, we're going to bring someone in who runs a call center that manages internet leads so that you can start learning about, you know, whether you do it yourself or you outsource it, how do you profit from those internet leads so that you're just not throwing them out the window when they come in? Because remember, someone might not be interested today, but if you have a system in place, you know, in 6 or 8 or 9 months, they may be interested, and they're going to remember the person that kept getting back to them. Remember, 75% of consumers are going to do business with the first person that gets back to them and that stays involved with them. On March 17th, we'll talk about how you can stay in touch after the sale in a much more professional, online savvy kind of manner that will give you an idea of when someone might be back in the market. And finally, on the 31st, we will discuss what the agent of the future is looking for. So that's the presentation. I'm going to go through and look at the questions that have been asked and try to answer some of them. And please feel free to either put them in the chat or just let me know. So the first question I have is, well, they're asking me, what is today's agent looking for? Well, you know, I will tell you that today's agent is looking for leadership. I mean, if you want to just be really general about it, that's what they're looking for. They're looking for leadership because, you know, in a lot of cases, if the broker that they work for is not doing the things that I'm talking about here, then if they understand how important those things are, they're going to feel like, gosh, maybe I need to be looking for another broker, and they're going to go out and they're going to look for the person that is doing these things. And I see it time and time again. I can tell you right now, ask yourself this question in your market, who is the innovator? And we travel a lot. We're at conferences, we're calling on people, we're helping our clients all over the country. And in most markets that I go to, there is maybe one innovator, in our opinion. And so you have an opportunity right now to be that person if you take charge and position yourself as that innovator. Somebody's asking a question about emailing the slides. We would be happy to email the slides. It will also be posted on our website in the next day or two. Somebody's asking me to slow down. Well, I guess it's too late because I'm done. But I apologize if I talk a little fast. I'm very passionate about this topic because I think it's very, very important. Let's see, any other questions here? Okay, yes, I will be at Real Estate Connect in New York next week and would be happy to set up some time to speak with you. Okay, so you want to say, somebody wants to see the short and long-term slides again. Well, let me back up and show you that. Well, I'll basically just, I'll send this to you, but let me just tell you as far as the short and the long-term slides, short and long-term goals, what's important about knowing that is that at the beginning, you know, you have to know, you know, how much you're able to afford to make these changes. You have to know who you have in terms of people on your team that can actually help you do this. It might be that it's just you, or it might be vice versa. You know, it may be a manager who's on this call right now who wants to help reinvent their company, but the owner is in the way. So it goes both ways. And so you have to start identifying what these things are and start getting the buy-in. And, you know, it might not be easy. But the important thing, and the reason why I say set goals and really focus on accomplishing smaller things first, is that if you have a few small wins, then people feel more and more comfortable. When we started our company 3 years ago, you know, even back then we were talking about reinventing and we were talking about social media. And at the beginning, you know, I didn't get that much buy-in from my folks, and we had a few successful situations we had one. Six-figure engagement that we got directly from our efforts online. So that's, I think, opened a few eyes. We got, you know, a lot of press on some of the things that we did on social media. So you just get out there and do it and have that mindset, and things will start happening for you, and everybody will start buying into it. How do you attract the agent of the future today without alienating the agent of yesterday? That's an excellent question, Derek. That's a high wire act, guys. You know, you don't want to upset your existing producing agents at the expense of, you know, I'm sorry, just to be able to recruit the agent in the future. So you have to, and it's, again, it's part of this whole strategy of trying to figure out, you know, what you got in place today. So we're consulting with a company in Atlanta right now, and they have a lot of older agents, but they know that they need to recruit younger agents. And so what they're doing is they're rallying around. They've got maybe 5 or 10 of their top producers that are you know, in their 50s and 60s that understand all this is important. And so remember that first slide where I talked about change, you know, build a consensus within even a small group within your company. Let them show everybody else how successful they can be, and let them basically speak for you to say, hey, listen, if it wasn't for, you know, my broker, You know, we'd be sitting here floundering, but my broker is an innovator who's taking chances and going out there and making these things happen. So, again, every situation is a little bit different, but you have to be cognizant of the fact that you have some existing agents that might have some heartburn with some of the things you might think about doing. But remember also, look at the long-term picture here. You know, if you don't make some of these changes, it's going to be difficult for you to be successful in the future. How will the brokerage of the future deal with the issue of making the least amount of dollars from the best agents and making the most amount of money from the middle tier agents? Okay, so he's basically saying, how do you make more money from the agents that are not as experienced? And again, you know, it's a balancing act. You have to determine, this is also part of determining, you know, what company you want to be, you know, who you want to be, and being true to that model. So I think, you know, personally, that we have to unshackle ourselves from these paradigms of the past and worrying about, you know, oh my God, what are my people going to think? And again, I'm not saying you ignore what your people are going to think, but you don't base every single decision on what they're going to think, because again, if they have any faith whatsoever in you, they're looking to you for leadership, especially today. There's not been a better time, in my opinion, for an owner of a company or a manager of a company to have an impact on their agents if they can prove that they're leaders. Any more questions? Would it make sense to spend more time with the productive agent, old or new, as opposed to the non-productive agent? Excellent question. here's the way I look at it is, first thing I want to know is this agent coachable, open to be held accountable, open to change, or is this person going to fight me every step of the way? And so I look at it and say, you know, as a leader, I owe it to all my team, not just, you know, one or two, if that makes a good leader. You can't, you know, have favorites, for example. All right, so I will tell you that you need to spend your time with your most productive people, because those are the ones that are buying into what you're doing. Those are the ones that are going to take you into the future, and those are the ones that are going to help you be a profitable company. If someone's fighting you along the way, yeah, I'm not saying you ignore someone who's struggling, but make sure that you spend time with someone who, you know, can be fixed. If they can't be fixed, either because they're not capable or because they've got a bad attitude, then you know what? Let them go, because at the end of the day, they're holding you down. Okay, somebody says they like our new website. Thank you very much. I think that's all the questions we have so far. Again, we have our next session on the 20th of this month, same time, and we look forward to seeing you there. Thank you very much, and for those of you that will be in New York, I'll see you there next week. Thank you very much.